was very worried, for his father was extremely ill and could not get well again. Except these two, there was no one at all in the little room. The light on the table was nearly extinguished. It was late in the evening. His father had told him he'd been a good son and that Providence would help him through the world. Then he looked at him with mild, earnest eyes, drew a deep breath, and died. It was just as if he slept. John wept, for now he had no one in the world, neither father nor mother, neither sister nor brother. He lay on his knees before the bed, kissed his dead father's hand, and shed many tears. But at last his eyes closed and he went to sleep, lying with his head against the hard bedpost. Then he dreamed a strange dream. He saw the sun and moon shine upon him, and there was his father again, fresh and well, and he heard his father laugh as he always had laughed.
And there was my father again,
a beautiful girl,
fresh and well, and I heard my father laugh as he always used to. A beautiful girl with a golden crown upon her long, shining hair gave me her hand, and my father said, "Do you see what a bride you have won? She is the most beautiful in the whole world."
Then he awoke, and all the splendor was gone. His father was lying dead and cold in the bed, and there was no one else with them. During the next week, the dead man was buried. The son walked close behind the coffin and could now no longer see the good father who had loved him so much. He heard them throw the earth down upon the coffin and stopped to see the last corner of it. But the next shovelful of earth hid even that. Around him they were singing a psalm. Those were sweet tones that arose, and the tears came into John's eyes. He wept. The little birds sat up in the chestnut trees and twittered. They were joyful and merry, though they had been at the burying, but they seemed to know that the dead man was now in heaven, and they were glad of it. John saw how they flew from the green trees out into the world, and he felt inclined to fly too. But first, he cut a big cross of wood to put on his father's grave. And when he took it there in the evening, the grave was decked with sand and flowers. Strangers had done this, for they were all very fond of the good man who was now dead. Early next morning, John packed his little bundle and put in his belt his whole inheritance, which consisted of 50 coins. And with this, he intended to wander out into the world. But first he went to the churchyard, to his father's grave, to say a prayer and to bid him farewell. Out in the field where he was walking, all the flowers stood fresh and beautiful in the warm sunshine, and they nodded in the wind, just as if they would have said, "Welcome to the green wood. Is it not fine here?" John thought what a number of wonderful things he would get to see in the world, and he went on, farther, farther than he had ever been before. The first night, he was obliged to lie down on a haystack in the field to sleep, for he had no other bed.
"Well, this is very nice. A king could hardly be better off. There's a whole field with the brook, the haystack, and the blue sky above it. This is certainly a beautiful bedroom. The green grass with the little red flowers is the carpet, and for a wash basin, I have the whole brook with clear fresh water. The moon is a marvelous night lamp beneath a ceiling of deep blue, and it's a lamp that will never set fire to the curtains at night."
John could sleep quite safely, and he did so, and never woke until the sun rose and all the little birds were singing around, "Good morning, good morning, are you not up yet?" It was Sunday. Out in the churchyard were many graves, and over some of them the grass grew high. Then he thought of his father's grave, which would finally look like these, as he could not weed it and adorn it. So he sat down and plucked up the long grass, set up the wooden crosses which had fallen down, and put back in their places the wreaths which the wind had blown away from the graves.
"Perhaps someone will do the same to my father's grave, as I cannot do it."
Outside the churchyard gate stood an old beggar, leaning upon his crutch. John gave him a coin, and then went on, happy and cheerful, along his route. Towards evening the weather became terribly bad. He made haste to get under shelter, but dark night soon came on. At last he came to a little church, which stood solitary on a small hill. He went in.
"I'll sit down in a corner. I need a little rest."
And before he was aware of it, he was asleep and dreaming while it thundered and lightened. When he awoke, it was midnight, but the bad weather had passed by, and the moon shone in upon him through the windows. In the midst of the church stood an open coffin with a dead man in it. John was not all that timid, for he had a good conscience, and he knew very well that the dead do not harm anyone. The living who do evil are bad men. Two such men stood close by the dead man, who had been placed there in the church till he would be buried. But they would not let him rest quietly in his coffin. They were going to throw him out in front of the church door.
"Why will you do that? Let him rest, for heaven's sake."
"Nonsense. He cheated us. He owed us money and could not pay it.
Now he's dead into the bargain.
We shall not get a penny.
So we shall revenge ourselves. He shall lie like a dog at the church door.
"Well, I've no more than 50 coins. And that is my whole inheritance. But I'll gladly give it to you, if you promise to leave the poor dead man in peace."
"Yes. If you will pay his debt, we will do nothing
to him. You may depend upon that."
And then they took the money he gave them, laughed aloud at his good nature, and went their way. John laid the corpse out again in the coffin, took leave of it, and went away contentedly through the forest. All around, wherever the moon could shine through between the trees, he saw the graceful little elves playing merrily. They did not let him disturb them. They knew that he was a good man. It is only the others who never get to see the elves. Some of them were no larger than a finger's breadth and had fastened up their long yellow hair with golden combs. They were rocking themselves two by two on the huge dewdrops that lay on the leaves and on the high grass. Sometimes a drop rolled away and then they fell down between the long grass stalks, causing much laughter and hubbub among the other little creatures. It was charming. They sang, and John recognized quite plainly the pretty songs which he'd learned as a little boy. Great coloured spiders with silver crowns on their heads had spun long hanging bridges and palaces from hedge to hedge, and as the tiny dewdrops fell on these, they looked like gleaming glass in the moonlight. This went on until the sun rose. Then the little elves crept into the flower buds, and the wind caught up their bridges and palaces, which flew about through the air. John had just come out of the wood when a voice called out behind him.
"Hello, friend. Where are you journeying?"
"Into the wide world.
Uh-huh.
I've neither father nor mother, and am poor. But Providence will help me."
"Well, I'm going into the wide world, too. Shall we two keep one another company?
Yes, certainly.
And so they went on together. Soon they became very attached to each other, for they were both good men. But John saw that the stranger was much cleverer than he himself. He had travelled through almost the whole world and knew almost everything. The sun already stood high when they seated themselves beneath a large tree to eat their breakfast. Just then an old woman came along. Oh, she was very old and walked quite bent, leaning upon a crutch. Upon her back she carried a bundle of firewood which she'd collected in the forest. Her apron was untied, and John saw three stalks of fern and some willow twigs peeping out. When she got close to them, her foot slipped. She fell and gave a loud scream, for she'd broken her leg, the poor old woman. John suggested that they carry the old woman home to her dwelling. But the stranger opened his knapsack, took out a little box, and said that he had a salve there, which would immediately make her leg whole and strong, so that she could walk home by herself, as if she'd never broken her leg at all. But for that, he required that she give him the three rods which she carried in her apron. The old woman nodded her head in a strange way. She did not like to give away the rods, but then it was not pleasant to lie there with a broken leg. So she gave him the wands. And as soon as he had rubbed the ointment on her leg, the old mother arose and walked much better than before. Such, it seems, was the power of the ointment. But then it was not to be bought at the chemist's.
What do you want for those rods?
Oh, they are three fine fern brooms. I like them. That's all.
And they went on a good way.
See how the sky is becoming overcast? Those are terribly thick clouds.
No, those are not clouds, they're mountains, glorious mountains, which go way up over the clouds and into the free air. Believe me, it is delicious.
But that was not so near as it looked. They had to walk for a whole day before they came to the mountains, where black woods grew straight up towards heaven, and there were stones almost as big as a whole town. It might certainly be hard work to get across them, and for that reason, John and his friend went into the inn to rest themselves. Down in the great common room in the inn, many guests were assembled, for a man was there with a puppet show. He'd just put up his little theatre, and the people were sitting around to see the play. In front, a fat butcher had taken his seat in the very best place. His huge bulldog, who looked rather inclined to bite, sat at his side, eyes open wide, as all the rest of the audience. Now the play began. It was a very nice play, with a king and a queen in it. They sat upon a beautiful throne and had gold crowns on their heads and long trains to their clothes, for they could afford that sort of thing. The prettiest of wooden dolls with glass eyes and large moustaches stood at all the doors and opened and shut them so that fresh air might come into the room. It was a very pleasant day, and not at all mournful. But goodness knows what the big bulldog can have been thinking of. Just as the queen stood up and was walking across the boards, as the fat butcher did not hold him, he made a spring upon the stage and seized the queen around her slender waist so that it cracked. It was quite terrible. The poor man who managed the play was very frightened and quite sorrowful about his queen, for she was the daintiest little doll he had, and now the ugly bulldog had bitten off her head. But afterwards, when the people went away, The stranger said that he would put her to rights again. And then he brought out his little box and rubbed the doll with the ointment with which he had cured the old woman when she broke her leg. As soon as the doll had been rubbed, she was whole again. Yes, she could even move all her limbs by herself. It was no longer necessary to pull her by her string. The doll was like a living person, only she could not speak. The puppet show man was very happy about this, for he wouldn't have to hold that doll anymore. She could dance by herself, and none of the others could do that. When night came on, and all the people in the inn had gone to bed, there was someone who sighed so fearfully, and went on doing it for so long, that they all got up to see who this could be. The puppet show man went to his little theatre, for it was there that somebody was sighing. All the wooden dolls lay mixed together, the king and all his followers. And it was they who sighed so pitiably and stared with their glass eyes, for they wanted to be rubbed a little as the queen had been, so that they might be able to move by themselves. The queen at once sank on her knees and stretched forth her beautiful crown as if she were begging, "Take this from me, but rub my husband and my courtiers." And then the poor man, the proprietor of the little theatre and the dolls, could not refrain from weeping, for he was really sorry for them. He immediately promised the travelling companion that he would give him all the money he should get the next evening if only he would anoint 4 or 5 of his dolls. But John's friend said he didn't require anything at all, except the sword the man wore by his side. And so, on receiving this, he anointed 6 of the dolls, who immediately began to dance so gracefully that all the girls, the living human girls, fell a-dancing too. The coachman and the cook danced, the waiter and the chambermaid, and all the strangers, and the fire shovel and tongs. But these fell down just as they made their first leaps. It was a merry, merry night. Next morning, John and his travelling companion left. They went high, high up the mountains and through the great pine woods. In fact, they got so high up that the church steeples below them looked like little blueberries among all the green. And they could see very far, many, many miles away, where they had never been. So much splendour in the lovely world John had never seen before. And the sun shone warm in the fresh blue air, and among the mountains he could hear the huntsmen blowing their horns so gaily and sweetly that tears came into his eyes, and he couldn't help calling out,
"How kind has heaven been to us, to give us all the splendor that is in this world!"
The travelling companion also stood there with folded hands and looked over the forest and the towns into the sunshine. At the same moment, lovely sounds arose over their heads. They looked up, and a white swan was soaring in the air with a sound never heard till then. But the song became weaker and weaker. He bowed his head and sank quite slowly down at their feet, where he lay dead. two such splendid wings, so white and large as those which this bird has, are worth a lot. I will take them with me." And so, with one blow, he cut off both the wings of the dead swan. They now travelled for many, many miles over the mountains, till at last they saw a large town before them with hundreds of towers, which glittered like silver in the sun. In the midst of the town was a splendid marble palace, roofed with pure red gold. And there the king lived. John and the travelling companion would not go into the town at once, but remained at the inn outside, so that they might prepare themselves, for they wanted to look nice when they went out into the streets. The host told them that the king was a very good man who never did harm to anyone, but his daughter, yes, goodness preserve us, she was a bad princess. She possessed beauty enough. No one could be so pretty and so charming as she was, but of what use was that? She was a wicked witch, through whose doing many gallant princes had lost their lives. She'd given permission to all men to seek her hand. Anyone might come, be he prince or beggar. It was all the same to her. He had only to guess three things she'd just thought of. If he could do that, she'd marry him, and he would be king over the whole country when her father should die. But if he could not guess the three things, she had him hanged, or had his head cut off. Her father, the old king, was very sorry about it, but he could not forbid her to be so wicked because he'd once said he would have nothing to do with her lovers. She might do as she liked. Every time a prince came and did not guess correctly, he was hanged or lost his head. The old king was so sorry for all this misery and woe that he used to lie on his knees with all his soldiers for a whole day once a year, praying that the princess might become good. But she would not. The old women who took brandy coloured it quite black before they drank it. They were in such deep mourning.
"That ugly princess! She ought really to have the rod. That would do her good. If I only were the old king, she should be punished."
Then they heard the people shouting, "Hurrah!" The princess came by. And she was really so beautiful that all the people forgot how wicked she was, and that is why they cried, "Hurrah!" 12 beautiful virgins, all in white silk gowns and each with a golden tulip in her hand, rode on coal black steeds at her side. The princess herself had a snow-white horse, decked with diamonds and rubies. Her riding habit was all of cloth of gold, and the whip she held in her hand looked like a sunbeam. The golden crown on her head was as little stars from the sky, and her mantle was sewn together out of more than 1,000 beautiful butterfly wings. In spite of this, she herself was much more lovely than all her clothes. When John saw her, his face became as red as a drop of blood, and he could hardly utter a word. The princess looked just like the beautiful lady with the golden crown of whom he had dreamt on the night his father had died. He found her so enchanting that he could not help loving her greatly. It could not be true that she was a wicked witch who caused people to be hanged or beheaded if they could not guess the riddle she put to them.
Everyone has permission to see her hand, even the poorest beggar. I will go to the castle.
They all told him not to attempt it, for certainly he would fare as the rest had done. His travelling companion, too, tried to dissuade him. but John thought it would end well. He brushed his shoes and his coat, washed his face and hands and combed his hair, and then went alone into the town and to the palace. The old king came towards him in a dressing gown and embroidered slippers. He had the crown on his head, a sceptre in one hand and the orb in the other.
Wait a little.
He put the orb under his arm so that he could reach out his hand to John. But as soon as he learned that his visitor was a suitor, he began to weep so violently that both the sceptre and the orb fell to the ground, and he was obliged to wipe his eyes with his dressing gown. Poor old king.
Give it up. You will fare badly as all the others have done. Well, you shall see.
Then he led him out into the princess's pleasure garden. That was a terrible sight. In every tree there hung three or four king's sons who had wooed the princess, but had not been able to guess the riddle she proposed to them. Each time the breeze blew, all the skeletons rattled so that the little birds were frightened and never dared come into the garden. All the flowers were tied up to human bones, and in the flower pots skulls stood and grinned. That was certainly a strange garden for a princess.
Here you see it. It will happen to you, as it happened to all you see here. You'd better give it up. You will really make me unhappy, for I take these things very much to heart.
John kissed the good old king's hand and said it would go well, for he was quite enchanted with the beautiful princess. Then the princess herself came riding into the courtyard with all her ladies. And they went out to her and wished her good morning. She was beautiful to look at, and she gave John her hand. And he cared much more for her then than before. She could certainly not be a wicked witch, as the people asserted. Then they went to the hall, and little pages waited upon them with preserves and gingerbread nuts. But the old king was quite sorrowful. He could not eat anything at all. And besides, gingerbread nuts were too hard for him. It was settled that John should go to the palace again the next morning. Then the judges and the whole council would be assembled and would hear how he got on with his answers. If it went well, he should come twice more. But no one had yet succeeded in guessing right the first time. And if he did not manage better than they, he must die. John was not at all anxious. On the contrary, he was merry, thought only of the beautiful princess, and felt quite certain that he should get help. But how, he did not know, and preferred not to think of it. He danced along the road, returning to the inn where his travelling companion was waiting for him. John could not stop talking about how polite the princess had been to him and how beautiful she was. He declared he already longed for the next day when he was to go into the palace and try his luck in guessing. But the travelling companion shook his head and was quite downcast.
I like you very much. We might have been together a long time yet. You poor fellow, I should say something, but I will not disturb your merriment on the last evening, perhaps, that we shall ever spend together. We will be merry, and tomorrow, when you've gone, well, that's another matter.
All the people in the town had heard that a new suitor for the princess had arrived, and there was great sorrow on that account. The theatre remained closed, the women who sold cakes tied bits of black crepe around their sugar men, and the king and the priests were on their knees in the churches. For John would not, they all thought, fare better than the other suitors had fared. Towards the evening, the travelling companion mixed a big bowl of punch.
Now we will be very merry and drink to the health of the princess.
But when John had drunk two glasses, he became so sleepy that he found it impossible to keep his eyes open, and he sank into a deep sleep. The travelling companion lifted him very gently from his chair and laid him in the bed. And when it grew to be dark night, he took the two great wings he'd cut off the swan and bound them to his own shoulders. Then he put in his pocket the longest of the rods he had received from the old woman who had fallen and broken her leg, and he opened the window and flew away over the town, straight towards the palace, where he seated himself in a corner under the window which looked into the bedroom of the princess. Was quiet in the whole town. Now the clock struck a quarter to 12. The window was open, and the princess came out in a long white cloak with black wings and flew away across the town to a great mountain. Travelling companion made himself invisible so that she couldn't see him at all, and flew behind her and whipped the princess with his rod so that the blood almost came whenever he struck. Through the air. The wind caught her cloak so that it spread out on all sides like a huge sail, and the moon shone through it. The princess cried out how she hated the hail, as every blow she got from the rod hurt her, and it served her right. Arrived at the mountain. There was a rolling like thunder, and the mountain opened, and the princess went in. The travelling companion followed her, for no one could see him. They went through a long passage where the walls shone in quite a peculiar way. There were more than 1,000 glowing spiders running up and down the walls and gleaming like fire. Then they came into a huge hall built of silver and gold. Flowers as big as sunflowers, red and blue, shone on the walls. But no one could pluck these flowers, for the stems were ugly, poisonous snakes, and the flowers were streams of fire pouring out of their mouths. The whole ceiling was covered with shining glowworms and sky-blue bats flapping their thin wings. It looked extraordinary. In the middle of the floor was a throne, carried by four skeleton horses with harness of fiery red spiders. The throne itself was of milk-white glass, and the cushions were little black mice biting each other's tails. Above it was a canopy of pink spider's web, trimmed with the prettiest little green flies which gleamed like jewels. On the throne sat an old magician with a crown on his ugly head and a scepter in his hand. He kissed the princess on the forehead, made her sit down beside him on the costly throne, and then the music began. Gigantic black grasshoppers played on jew's harps, and the owl beat her wings upon her body because she hadn't a drum. That was a strange concert. Little black goblins with jack-o'-lantern light on their caps danced about in the hall. But no one could see the travelling companion. He'd placed himself just behind the throne and heard and saw everything. The courtiers who now came in were very grand and noble. But he who could see it all knew very well what it all meant. They were nothing more than broomsticks with heads of cabbage on them, which the magician had animated by his power and to whom he had given embroidered clothing. But that did not matter, for you see, they were only wanted for show. After there'd been a little dancing, the princess told the magician that she had a new suitor and asked him what she should think of to ask the suitor when he should come tomorrow to the palace.
Listen, I will tell you that. You must do something very easy for anyone to think on it. Think of one of your shoes. That he will not guess. Let him have his head cut off. But don't forget, when you come to me tomorrow night, bring me his eyes, for I'll eat them.
The princess curtsied very low and said she would not forget the eyes. The magician opened the mountain and she flew home again. But the travelling companion followed her and beat her again so hard with the rod that she sighed quite deeply about the heavy hailstorm and hurried as much as she could to get back into the bedroom through the open window. The travelling companion, for his part, flew back to the inn, where John was still asleep, took off his wings, and then lay down upon the bed, for he might well be tired. It was quite early in the morning when John awoke. The travelling companion also got up, and said he'd had a wonderful dream about the princess and her shoe, and he therefore begged John to ask if the princess had not thought about her shoe. For it was this he had heard, of course, from the magician in the mountain.
Well, I mean, perhaps it's quite right what you dreamt. But I'd better say farewell. For if I guess wrong, I shall never see you again.
John went into the town and to the palace. The entire hall was filled with people. The judges sat in their armchairs and had eiderdown pillows behind their heads, for they had a great deal to think about. The old king stood up and wiped his eyes with a white pocket handkerchief. She was much more beautiful than yesterday, and bowed to all in a very affable manner. And to John she gave her hand. Now John was to guess what she had thought of. Oh, how lovingly she looked at him. But as soon as she heard the single word shoe pronounced, she became as white as chalk in the face and trembled all over. John had guessed right. Wonderful! How glad the old king was! He threw a somersault beautiful to behold, and all the people clapped their hands in honor of him and of John, who had guessed right the first time. The travelling companion was very glad, too, when he heard how well matters had gone. John felt very grateful, and he was sure he should receive help the second and third time as he'd been helped the first. The next day, he was to guess again. The evening passed just like that of yesterday. While John slept, the travelling companion flew behind the princess out to the mountain and beat her even harder than the time before, for now he had taken two rods. No one saw him, and he heard everything. The princess was to think of her glove, and this again he told John as if it had been a dream. Once more John guessed right, and this caused great rejoicing in the palace. The whole court threw somersaults, just as they had seen the king do the first time, but the princess lay on the sofa and would not say a single word. Now the question was, if John could guess properly the third time, if he succeeded, he was to have the beautiful princess and inherit the whole kingdom after the old king's death. If he failed, he was to lose his life, and the magician would eat his handsome blue eyes. That evening John went early to bed. The travelling companion bound his wings to his back and his sword by his side and took all three rods with him, and so flew away to the palace. It was a very dark night. The wind blew so hard that the tiles flew off from the roofs, and the trees in the garden where the skeletons hung bent like reeds before the storm. The lightning flashed out, and the thunder rolled just as if it were one peal lasting the whole night. Now the window opened, and the princess flew out. She was as pale as death. But she laughed at the bad weather and declared that it was not bad enough yet. And her white cloak crackled in the wind. But the travelling companion beat her with the three rods so that the blood dripped and she could scarcely fly any further. However, she arrived at the mountain. This time, the magician, furious though he was, thought of something that would not possibly be guessed by the princess's suitor. His head. As the traveling companion heard these words, he knew what he must do. The princess flew away from the mountain, and as soon as she was out of sight, the traveller seized the magician by his beard and cut off his head. Wrapping it in a large handkerchief, after dipping it for a while in some water, he flew back after the princess, beating her all the way back to the castle. Next morning he gave John the handkerchief and told him not to untie it until the princess asked him to tell her thoughts. There were so many people in the great hall of the palace that they stood as close together as radishes bound together in a bundle. The consul sat in the chairs with the soft pillows, and the old king had new clothes on. The golden crown and scepter had been polished, and everything looked quite stately. But the princess was very pale, and had a coal black dress on, as if she were going to be buried.
Tell me what I was thinking of.
And he immediately untied the handkerchief, and was himself quite frightened when he saw the ugly magician's head. All present shuddered, for it was terrible to look upon. But the princess sat just like a statue, and would not utter a single word. At length she stood up, and gave John her hand, for he had guessed well. All present cried, "Hurrah!" The soldiers' band played music in the streets, the bells rang, and the cake women took off the black crepe from their sugar dolls, for now joy reigned. 3 oxen, roasted whole and stuffed with ducks and fowls, were placed in the middle of the market, that everyone might cut himself a slice. The fountains ran with the best wine, and whoever bought a penny cake at a baker's got 6 biscuits into the bargain, and the biscuits had raisins in them. In the evening, the whole town was illuminated. The soldiers fired off cannon and the boys lit off crackers. And there was eating and drinking, clinking of glasses and dancing in the palace. Still, the princess was a witch and did not like John. This occurred to the travelling companion, and so he gave John 3 feathers out of the swan's wings and a little bottle with a few drops in it, and told John that he must put a large tub of water before the princess's bed. And when the princess was about to get into bed, he should give her a little push so that she'd fall into the tub. Then he must dip her 3 times after putting in the feathers and pouring in the drops. She would then, he said, lose her magic qualities and love him at last. John did all the travelling companion had told him. The princess screamed out loudly while he dipped her in the tub and struggled under his hands, taking the form of a coal black swan with fiery eyes. When she came up the second time above the water, the swan was white, with the exception of a black ring around her neck. John let the water close for the 3rd time over the bird, and at the same moment it was changed into the lovely princess. She was more beautiful even than before, and thanked him with tears for having saved her and freed her from the magic spell. The next morning the old king came with his whole court, and then there was great celebration till late into the day. Last of all came the travelling companion. He had his staff in his hand and his knapsack on his back. John hugged him and said he must not depart, he must remain with the friend of whose happiness he was the cause. But the travelling companion shook his head and said mildly and kindly,
"No, my time is up. I've paid my debt. Do you remember the dead man whom those bad people wished to injure? You gave all you possessed in order that he might rest in his grave. I am that man."
And at the same moment, he vanished. The wedding festivities lasted a whole month, John and the princess loved each other truly, and the old king passed many pleasant days and let their children ride on his knees and play with his scepter. And John afterwards became king over the whole land.